Marco was able to tell us a whole bunch of positive stuff there, and I'm envious because my job is to tell you about the use of ultrasound to measure muscle structure or muscle architecture, and how we also use it to try to marry up the changes in muscle architecture with changes in function. And of course, we've been a little bit less successful in that in some ways, and I thought maybe the best way to tell you about these technologies and how to use them and what we need to do in the future might be to walk you through some of our mistakes so that you can maybe do something a bit different from us. Of course, many years ago, I was lucky enough to read a few seminal papers that made it very, very clear that the most important factor influencing a muscle's force production capacity is, of course, its architecture. And that refers to the length of the muscle, the cross-sectional area of the muscle, but also the pronation angle or fascicle angle, if it's relative to the aponeurosis, and the length of the fibers or fascicles that make up the muscle. And of course, anyone who's young and silly would realize that if you could then use exercise training to manipulate that architecture, we could then change significantly the function and create the superhumans we wanted to create. At the time, one of my colleagues was trying to create superhumans by injecting testosterone into weight trainers. That was going to be the new male contraceptive pill, which makes it a bit easier to get it through ethics. And we realized there was an opportunity here to see whether these subjects had an altered architectural response. And of course, we measured in the triceps surae, which some others had done in Japan previously, and we found that, in fact, there was a very significant increase in fascicle length, fascicle angle. This made a lot of sense, and it predicted the strength increase much more than the muscle size. Of course, you can probably also see that these images weren't necessarily very well done at the time, and we really worry about the use of ultrasound in this respect in this day and age that we know a lot more. My own research, we were trying to take sprint, jump, sort of field team sport athletes and change their training. I wanted to add speed and jump training, but subtract the strength training from a group of athletes and compare that to other athletes who also added speed and jump training, but maintained their strength training. Actually, I gave them different plans, and you'll see that there are multiple groups, but the key is they maintained their strength training. And when we measured the pronation angles and fascicle lengths in the vastus lateralis as well as in rectus femoris, I won't show you all the data, we measured from multiple sites within the muscles. What we start to see for fascicle angle is not a lot of change in the two weight training groups that continued the strength training, but maybe a loss of pronation angle in the group that removed their strength training. We thought maybe that would improve the efficiency of force transfer, but as you know, it probably is also a hallmark of a loss of peak strength in the muscle. We also looked at fascicle length. And again, if you continue the heavy weight training, there is not a lot of change in the fascicle length, but at this time, in the group that had a bias towards sprint and jump training by removing strength training, we see this significant increase in fascicle length. And if this is reflective of the number of sarcomeres in series, then this should improve the speed capacity of the muscle. So everything looked fantastic. Of course, you'll also see that this is a very large change in fascicle length, which of course is probably absolutely impossible in human muscle, and did suggest that we had some errors in the way we were using ultrasound at the time. So, of course, what we did show is that the changes in muscle architecture are very rapid. It's not just the case that neural adaptations are the first things that happen in muscle, but we did have a problem. And as someone who wanted to improve speed and power in athletes, of course, I wanted to know if it was possible to lengthen these fibers to improve the speed potential of muscle whilst maintaining or even increasing the fascicle length whilst they strength train. Of course, there are other factors that influence performance, like the force-length relationship or the torque-angle relationship as we often measure it, and I wanted to know if there was a way that we could manipulate that as well. And of course, like anyone who wants to get rich, good-looking, cure cancer, increase fascicle lengths, you all know the best way to do that is with eccentric training. And we had seen these downhill running studies by David Morgan's group in Melbourne, where an increase or a greater number of sarcomeres in series was not only related to, in previous studies to velocity potential, but here to the force-length relationship. And running uphill, where there are predominantly concentric contractions, gave us a different force-length relation. So we then performed a study using isokinetic dynamometry, comparing a concentric training group who, after 10 weeks, only saw very small changes in the force at different joint angles, to a group who trained only eccentrically for 10 weeks and who therefore showed a dramatic shift toward longer muscle lengths, which of course would be suggestive of an increase in the length of the fibres. What we then did was pull this together and compare the change in the fascicle length with over time with the shift in the torque angle relation. And we saw this fantastic overlay, and I was very excited, of course, as a young researcher, to show that maybe the changes in fascicle length marry up very well with the change in physical function. Of course, there was one little anomaly here, and that is, in contrast to a lot of the animal studies, we found an increase in fascicle length in concentric training, although you've seen Marco's group show a small increase as well. But we also saw the same, or actually a slightly smaller increase in the eccentric group. So at the time, I started to get a bit nervous that eccentric training was this really excellent way to increase fascicle length. Now, I wasn't the only one necessarily to show this. Other people maybe showed that different forms of training weren't changing muscle architecture. People were maybe showing trends or differences between people, but the studies were not matching. And therefore, I started to get a little bit nervous that maybe there were the relationships between the muscle structure and function were not being reliably observed, at least when we measure these with ultrasound in vivo in humans. And of course, at the time, by this time, I'd also started reading a bit more of the animal literature, and there are a few issues with the animal literature as well. For example, Walter Herzog decided to get into this research, and of course, they performed dorsiflexor eccentric training in their rats. And whilst, of course, in some areas of the muscle, we see these really nice increases in sarcomere number, at other areas of the muscle, there was no change or even a significant decrease in the number of sarcomeres. And in other studies, they've observed very small changes or no changes at all. And in only one part of the muscle in this group did they show a very small change. And of course, there was no concentric control group, so we weren't too sure whether this was really a change evoked by the eccentric nature of the contractions. And in this study, Walter Herzog had a student, Tim Butterfield, who tried to replicate the Dave Morgan sort of uphill, downhill running studies. And in the vastus intermedius found identical results, that downhill running, where there should be a lot of eccentric action, increases the number of sarcomeres, but the uphill running with the concentric reduces them. But what I found interesting in this study is that looking at the larger vastus lateralis muscle, they found a decrease in serial sarcomere number in both the uphill and downhill groups. Now, the downhill group didn't reach statistical significance because of this single outlier. So that's another thing we need to remember, is to show everyone all of our data so that we can make different conclusions if we like. But I found it very interesting that we saw a loss of sarcomere number with eccentric or downhill running, and in good scientific practice, of course, Walter had shown using sonar micrometry that when the muscle was active running downhill, the muscle was lengthening, but it's not active in shortening. Active in lengthening, not active in shortening. But what they also seemed to show here was that the muscle was active at short but not long muscle lengths. Short but not long muscle lengths. So in fact, in this model, there are two different things going on, at least, within these muscles. Of course, we also don't know the exact force magnitudes. So I wondered if what this was really showing us is that if you activate a muscle a lot at a certain muscle length, this might also have an influence on the number of sarcomeres in series. And this matched a lot of previous data in animals, for example, from Susan Herring's group, looking at the masseter muscle in pigs. They tried to figure out what was the major factor that influenced the sarcomere number. And of course, it turned out to be predominantly regulated such that the sarcomere length was optimum, the overlap between the filaments, when the highest levels of tension were afforded, and that's when the muscle was most electrically active. So I thought, well, this sounds like an interesting way to look at this. If you activate a muscle with a certain length, it will adapt to that length by changing sarcomere number. So of course we can have an experimental design using isometric contractions, and that takes away this idea of contraction mode specificity. But herein lay the problem, is that in previous studies we didn't have great ultrasound measurements. We had probes that of course couldn't see the entire fascicles, which meant we had a lot of extrapolation error. And we knew this even though we had high reliabilities that we weren't although getting very accurate measurements. Now, there are ways around this, and of course, I was very jealous. I was living in London at the time, and a couple of hundred kilometres up the road, Costas Magnaris and Marco Nerici had these incredible 10-centimetre probes that I didn't have. You've seen these before, and it allowed them to fit entire fascicles, or more or less the entire fascicle, on the screen, and they got really nice results. Tip number one, if you're looking for a new ultrasound system, there are in fact some very inexpensive systems that have access to these very long probes, and they are relatively easy to use. If you have a few hundred hours worth of experience, you can get really nice images like these ones. But of course, I'd moved to Australia at some point, and I was lucky enough to get this extended field of view technology. And what we do with the extended field of view technology is we place the probe over the muscle and then find the correct orientation of fascicles and the correct probe orientations and mark that on the skin. We then move by approximately half of the length of the probe, and remark it, and then again, and then again, and again. What this allows us to do is try to follow the 3D curvature of the muscle, because of course we can change the direction rather than using a straight line. We can change the plane of the probe as we image, and of course the probe can see in the other dimension, and we get these really nice sort of clear fascicle delineations. And if you compare, as we did in this study, to even a wide probe, I mean, 6 centimeters is a pretty good probe. If you compare the direct measurement to the extrapolation, we can see that there are some errors here. And this is really important, of course, in other muscles that are becoming much more highly studied. This is the biceps femoris lateral head, a really sexy muscle at the moment. Here's the intra-muscular aponeurosis that divides the muscle and creates this very complicated architecture. And you can see here that the fascicle even has at least 2 main curves as it follows its path, which means if you're using an imaging window like this, you're guessing exactly where it goes, but you have no actual idea. And we've just done some studies that I think should come out very soon. I know they've been accepted, but they show this error and how it relates to the probe width. I'd very strongly suggest if you're doing this complex type muscles, you use extended field of view. And this is the case no matter what length of the muscle. This is distal in BF. This is more proximal in BF. It's very hard to guess where those fascicles are going to go. But of course, architecture varies along the lengths of muscles, but also within a synergistic group, it varies a lot between the muscles. And as you've already seen from previous data, the way the different regions change with training are also very, very selective. What it means is, if we're going to do these studies, we need to have good imaging opportunities, but we need to take these images from multiple muscles in a synergistic group and at multiple lengths along the group to know what we're seeing. So once we had this technology, we thought, well, we're ready to go. So what we did is we got a whole bunch of subjects, measured their torque angle curve for knee extension. We then got some x-rays to look at their moment arm to resolve this and actually, or estimate, the muscle force. And then we could train one group at a long muscle length where we could sit their angle so that this was 85% of whatever their best force was. And then a short muscle length group, so we extend the knee, would train when their opportunity to produce maximum force was only 80%. So now we've got the same velocity, I0, same contraction mode, isometric, same relative force, about 80% of what they are at their peak angle, and we're ready to try and understand the effect of this on fascicle changes. Of course, the problem is, short muscle length group, no hypertrophy at all. There's an interesting take-home message. And what we see with the muscle architecture, at least the fascicle length, is an increase in fascicle length at one of the 4 regions that we studied. This isn't what we expected from the animal data, and of course disproved our hypotheses. I told you we get it wrong every time. The long muscle length group, however, experienced significant hypertrophy, take-home message. They also, however, showed an increase in fascicle length at just one of these 4 sites. The increase was the same as the short muscle length group. Notice here that if we had have only measured from the middle of VL, which is common in a lot of studies, we would have come to the erroneous conclusion that short muscle length training increases fascicle length and long muscle does not. And it shows you how fickle these measurements are if we're only measuring from one site in a complex muscle group. More importantly, we found no relationship at all between the change in fascicle length and the shift in the torque angle curve. So we invalidated or found the opposite of our previous data. So even I can't get my results to match, which makes things a little bit disconcerting, I think. By the way, you'll have to read the paper, but the torque angle shift was more related to learning or muscle activation in this group and selective or regional hypertrophy in this group. But I have to move on. Of course, fascicle length also affects velocity characteristics in muscle. So if they both increased fascicle length, at least in one section of the muscles that we measured, maybe they would increase their force at higher velocities. But in neither group did we see that. However, there was only an increase in slow velocity torque in the long muscle length group. And again, you have to read the paper, it was associated with hypertrophy, but only in very specific regions of these muscles. Either way, we couldn't find any relationship between the changes in fascicle length and the changes in the function in vivo using our own nervous systems to drive the movement. So maybe when even we use the most reasonably good measures in multiple sites, the structure-function relationships are very difficult to observe in vivo. One main reason for this, of course, is that humans are very complicated. Huge number of changes appear. It doesn't mean architecture is not important. It just means that it's hard to observe. Now, there are a couple of ways we can use ultrasound to help us get around this, and we've been doing this a bit more recently. The first one is we can use this extended field methodology to also measure the cross-sectional area of the muscle. And again, it takes honestly hundreds of images to practice on before you can get really nice, reliable results. But we've validated this against some scanning in vivo and animal muscles and everything else. And once we've developed this technique, we could then use our EFOV to measure not only the cross-sectional area, but the fascicle geometry in multiple muscles. And when you combine this with, for example, measurements of the joint moment arms, measurements of activation of the muscle, so the twitch interpolated technique, EMG M-wave ratios, we're ready to start trying to build these models that might predict muscle functional characteristics. And in this study, cross-sectional study in 58 men, we were just trying to predict peak torque. And here you can see we can predict peak torque isometrically and concentrically quite well in this group. And we build different models and then we test models against each other. And if we have a really good model that includes cross-sectional area, some measure of activation, on this one of the best models included the moment arm, and then we add architectural variables to it, such as the pronation angle, we see a significant improvement in the model's capacity to predict. And this is interesting that adding architecture, like the pronation angle, did this, because actually if all we did was run the correlation, we see a very poor correlation between strength and pronation. In other words, if we had measured all of this pronation all over the quadriceps using the best methods, and all we did was a correlation, we would have said pronation doesn't matter. But once we add it to an existing model, it makes a substantial improvement in our predictive ability. We believe, therefore, that the pronation angle is really important. But it's probably important if you've already got cross-sectional area or already got a moment arm. Notice, by the way, that the best model here used the CSA measured proximally, not in the middle of the thigh. This was the same in a training study on 36 men, which we haven't published yet. The prediction's not as perfect because, of course, people don't change as much as the difference between people. But again, poor correlation with pronation, add it to a model, the model significantly improves. And by the way, again, it's the proximal measure that seemed to be most predictive, region specific, I guess. So using these model approaches, I think we can start to examine the combinations of variables and synergies between them. And we, of course, now have to look at the effects of fascicle length and all these other things on muscle function. There is another opportunity. We know that to measure force, we're going to have to try and account for a huge number of other variables to delve into the effect of muscle architecture. What you could do, of course, is simply measure the function of the muscle in vivo. Oh, just lost the video. Let me see if it plays this way. There we go. You could, of course, watch the muscle function during concentric, eccentric, or other movements. Here, we're not measuring the force output. What we're going to do is simply see if the changes with training affect the way the muscle functions in a repeatable task. Now, what we haven't yet done is to see whether the changes in muscle architecture with training that we observe at rest underpin the changes we see during muscle contraction. And that's an area of future research, I think. Of course, we have the same problem. You cannot measure whole fascicles using this kind of technique, and of course we can't use
EFOV, or extended field of view, because you need the muscle to be held static. The alternative, use the Nerici probe, 10 centimeters, you get some really good muscles using that. An alternative is to have or to borrow an additional ultrasound system, put two image probes in a casing like this, and then when you join these together after in post-processing, you can then very quite accurately, I think, measure fascicle lengths and angles and look at the gearing effect in human muscle. And Ken Nasaka and a bunch of great Japanese researchers have recently done this to look at how vastus intermedius and lateralis differ quite significantly in how they function under concentric and eccentric activities. There is one last point I want to make to finalize here, and that is, of course, we all want to see how to change muscle architecture and how it will affect performance, but we really should start with the hypothesis, the null hypothesis, that there is no effect. And I'll just give you one example of how that might actually be possible after all this. Here is a standard model of the force-velocity relationship. Let's pretend, of course, that we've done some form of training that increases the length of the fascicles by 10%. And that increase is caused by an increase in the number of sarcomeres in series. That would not affect the isometric contraction strength of the muscle, but it will affect the velocity capacity. The unloaded velocity will increase by 10%, proportional to sarcomere number. And of course, you see then that at intermediate velocities, that will increase the amount of force we see at any point. But herein lies one problem. Most humans perform slow movements on a daily basis. And when we perform very high speed movements, for example, like sprint running, actually it's tendon recoil, not the muscle speed itself, that provides this power, as you saw with Tetsuo Fukunaga's presentation. In fact, the fascicle shortening velocity of the gastrocnemius in sprinting, according to Adrian Lay and Marcus Pandy's work, is about 0.4 lengths per second. And at this velocity, it is possible that the effect of fascicle lengthening is not so much visible in our measurements and may not have physiological relevance. So two things. One, please prove me wrong. Number two, maybe when we do our resting architecture measurements, if we're unable to correlate that with actual physical function because of all the mess that we see, perhaps an opportunity is to put those numbers into some sort of model to see if the model predicts that it would have some sort of functional output. And I think we can maybe make use of certain models in the future to look at this. So to summarize, between muscles, there is a significant difference in the architecture of muscle. And this architecture is the most important factor influencing the force production potential of our muscles. However, in humans, we don't always see this great relationship between changes in architecture and changes in muscle function. It's possible it's because it's not important, or at least the effects are so small given the changes we can make. But we can't come to that null hypothesis until we get our methods correct. And I think with ultrasound imaging, it's going to be very important in the future to use the highest quality imaging possible to measure whole fascicles every time in the correct plane, measuring from multiple muscles within a synergistic group and multiple lengths along those muscles. And then if the opportunity provides itself, consider using these modeling approaches by measuring as much other stuff as you can and then adding architectural variables to a predictive model, or directly measure the muscles function during the movement without necessarily worrying about the force output of the muscle.